Quantum computing is a proposal for how to use the laws of physics to solve certain specific problems much, much faster than we know how to solve them with conventional computers.
Quantum computing is a way that we can represent how nature operates in a way that we could never approximate it through our creation of digital semiconductor-based computing.
In the future, quantum computing, in particular when teamed up with AI training hardware, will be able to solve a next generation of problems.
Quantum computing, what is it? As a business person, when I started looking into it, I was shocked by all the hype. So I want to get right into what matters to us, and that is, how's it different from classical computing? Who will it impact, and who needs to prepare? Spoiler alert, you do. And finally, how close is it to reality? The answer is, closer than you think. My name is Adrian Mikowajczyk, and I love my job. At Infineon Technologies, I get to go behind the scenes and see new upcoming technologies, not yet public, that could impact your future. So let's get started.
The discovery that really put quantum computing on the map for most of the world came about 30 years ago when a mathematician, Peter Shor, showed that a quantum computer would be able to quickly find the prime factors of enormous numbers. Anytime you order anything on the internet or you visit any website, you know, with HTTPS, your private data is being protected by a cryptographic code that depends on the belief that factoring huge numbers is hard. What Shor showed is that if people can build large quantum computers, that will no longer be true. So almost all of the encryption that currently protects the internet could be broken. And Shor's algorithm really started a race to figure out what else could a quantum computer be good for, besides quantum simulation and breaking public key encryption. The idea was introduced about 45 years ago. In the early 80s, Feynman and a few other physicists said, why don't we build a computer that itself would be made of qubits that could be in superposition states, that would have this exponential number of amplitudes, that could exploit interference between the amplitudes. Supposing that you built that device, what they called a quantum computer, what would it be good for? And at that time, they really only knew one answer to that question, which was it would be good for simulating quantum mechanics itself. I would say decades later, that is still the most important practical answer that we know. Okay, a quantum computer could help understanding the rate of a chemical reaction that might be involved in making fertilizer, in a drug, you know, binding to a protein, building high temperature superconductors, building better batteries, better solar cells. These are all many body quantum physics problems. These are not the things that most of us are using our computers for, but even just a few successes here could form the basis of billion-dollar industries. There's another very important quantum algorithm called Grover's algorithm. What Grover's algorithm lets you do is take any list of n possible solutions to some problem where you know how to check each one and search that list for a good solution using a number of steps that grows only like the square root of n. So for example, you could search a list of a million possible solutions in about 1,000 steps. That has applications to just about everything we do in computer science. Combinatorial optimization in search, finance, constraint satisfaction, AI, you name it. The drawback is that the speed up is not an exponential one like it is for Shor's algorithm. Okay, the speed up from Grover's algorithm is more modest.
Welcome to Quantinuum. Today I'll show you our Broomfield, Colorado facility and how we're building the world's most powerful quantum computers.
Quantinuum, world's largest quantum computing company, about 600 folks, all focused on making quantum computing real and being used for good.
Our next generation machine was the system model H2, and with this one we are trapping 56 qubits. The most powerful supercomputers in the world cannot simulate this chip.
The biggest systems, they are digital twin machines. If you want to build an aircraft, you have a digital twin of an aircraft. If you want to build a combustion engine, you have a digital twin. What is the value? The digital twin is much more amenable to experimentation. You can predict things with it, like what if I change this? How would it react with the environment? So it gives you a lab to deal with for that object. but it can't represent certain things. Like, how does a peptide bind to a cell in your body? For those are governed by quantum mechanical principles, and you cannot use an approximate form of computing to get a good understanding or representation of those phenomena. That's where quantum computing comes in. How do you build drug delivery material that takes the medicine and delivers it into your body, protects it from being distributed all over your body, takes it to where the medicine is needed, and then does a very controlled release of the medicine based on certain external factors, like I shine a light on it. Quantum computing can help do the actual chemistry of the interaction of the medicine with the vessel, the holder, as well as its interactions with the environment, which is inside your body. This is the next future of human control, understanding that leads to the ability to control those kinds of phenomena that lead to better outcomes. And that's what quantum computing is uniquely suited to do, working in many cases with classical computing to achieve this end.
But eventually, to get to where we want to go with very large scale fault-tolerant quantum computing, we again need to turn to microfabrication, and we're working with Infineon to develop photons integrated into a chip. And here we're doing testing of some of these early chips.
So far, no one has found any obstacle of fundamental physics that says, here's why you can't build a quantum computer. There have been skeptics from the very beginning who said, this sounds absurd. We've now seen that we really can apply thousands of operations to hundreds of qubits, create very complicated entangled states, choreograph patterns of interference of these amplitudes, and everything works just like the theory said it would. Yes, there is error, but so far the error seems to be entirely of a sort that the theory of quantum error correction was designed to handle. A big challenge is going to be scaling, right? Because ultimately we want to deal not just with two or three logical qubits, but with thousands of logical qubits. Okay, if you want a benefit for simulating quantum systems, or for breaking cryptographic codes, or Grover, or any of the other stuff.
2 years ago, we were talking about somebody show the first logical qubit. We went from someone will show to now having demonstrated 28. And then we are now on a path to 50 logical qubits. And then by 27, we'll have 100. That's the rate of progress. 100 logical qubits is considered enough computation. It's not enough forever, but it's enough to start showing some of these use cases having real value. And that 100 logical qubits is generally understood as one of the points, one of the early points where you can start to see real commercial applications. And so the industry view that once was, it's going to be a few decades away, has now become, we are in the next business planning cycle. If I'm an enterprise, I have to ask myself, as I look at cloud and AI, how am I going to incorporate quantum? And if I don't, what disadvantage do I cause myself? So AI and quantum together, which we call Gen Q AI, is a great help to quantum. AI is a great help to quantum because it doesn't have to have quantum be 100% correct or get as accurate, because the two can work together in a way that 1 + 1 is greater than 2.
We as Infineon started to invest in quantum computing back in 2017 already. We believe that quantum computing will be the next big transformational technology to really push the frontiers of what is possible with respect to simulations and computation. Quantum computing is very real already. We are building hardware. We have wafers with ion traps that we built for our lead customers. That's no longer just science, that's engineering, and engineering, this is what we are really good at. The key thing in making quantum computing usable is to have high amount of qubits, but also have them in the right fidelity, so with very low error rates. And what we as Infineon contribute to this challenge is the technological foundation and our manufacturing processes that allow to scale these qubits in a high fidelity.
Quantum computers are extremely complex systems, so there are lots of challenges both on the hardware side and also the operational side. The two biggest challenges are scaling and reliability. if you want to build a useful quantum computer, you need not only hundreds of qubits, but thousands or millions of qubits. And you need a system, a device that hosts that many qubits. Then you need to control all these qubits so that you can perform quantum computing on a reliable level. We build ion trap devices. These work with single ions that are used as qubits.
In order to use ions as qubits, they are kept afloat, typically 100 micrometers above the chip surface. This puts them in perfect isolation from their environment. They're just floating there in cryogenic vacuum, and consequently, they exhibit the longest coherence times of any qubit modality. Coherence times have been shown to exceed hours, and they are essentially infinite. They are controlled with the highest precision. The so-called two-qubit fidelity is now approaching 99.99%, and that's essential for executing complex and deep quantum circuits. The ions can also move across the chip. We call this shuttling. That's very powerful because it enables each and every ion to talk to one another and helps to execute quantum circuits in an efficient manner. Infineon is a world-leading semiconductor company, which means we have thousands of passionate engineers, tools, processes across several sites. So when it comes to technology, we will find a solution to every problem.
I think this is the future. I think there was a lot of progress in ion trap development, quantum computing development the last years. One day we will really be able to perform useful quantum computing.
I hope this gave you some new perspectives on quantum computing and how it'll impact your business. So with that, thanks for watching and stay innovative.